Dear learners, in the last lesson, we learned about what is social research, what is scientific research, and then we learned about the methods of research in sociology, and we learned about the functional method, we learned about many other methods in the last lesson. Also, we were learning about the various types of data. In today's lesson, we will be learning more on the techniques of research in sociology. You all know that when we undertake a research project or when we try to understand social phenomena, we use various techniques and methods to understand and interpret social phenomena. So in today's session, we will be learning about these various techniques of research to understand and interpret social phenomena. Though there are various techniques which is used by many sociologists, these techniques sometimes can be used simultaneously together. To start with, when we look into the objectives of what we are going to do today, we will be learning about the techniques of data collection like observation, survey, the case study, questionnaire, and interview. These are the various techniques which we will be discussing. To start with, the observation method. Learners, you already know that observation in simple terms would be meaning watching things with certain purpose in view. But when we use it in research, it might mean a specific purpose which should be there within the researcher's mind when he or she tries to observe a particular social phenomena. In social science researches, it is a systematic and deliberate study to understand the spontaneous occurrence of events. It is in fact a standardized plan and systematic approach to objectively observe and record behavior. Learners, sometimes you must have seen or checked people who are studying certain behavior patterns of people. For example, the consumer behavior patterns of people. People can look into, go to malls or go to shopping centers and see what people are buying, what people are purchasing, how they are spending their money, on what items they are spending their money, what are the primary items which they are purchasing from these shops. So this kind of understanding of social phenomena would be the observation method, because there is something, a well-defined plan to look into social behavior or social phenomena. So observation method, definitely it's through a standardized plan when you observe certain behavior pattern or record behavior of people through a planned effort. When we look into research practices which is done in social sciences, we see that many sociologists long time back have studied and till now continue to use the observation method as an important technique to study or understand social phenomena. When we look into the advantages of observation method, there are many advantages of this method. In the observation method, the subjective bias is eliminated if it is done accurately. If you observe a particular thing, observation is with a free mind. So the subjective bias is not present there in the mindset of the researcher or of the person who is undertaking the study. The information obtained under this method relates to what is currently happening. It is not complicated by either the past behavior or future intentions or attitudes of people. So when we observe a particular incident, a particular phenomena, we observe the incident directly as it is. We do not observe it with a backup in the mind or with a bias in the mind which will be affected by the past behavior or the future intentions or attitudes. So observation mostly, generally, you can say, is free from bias. This method is independent of the respondent's willingness to respond and is less demanding of active cooperation on the part of the respondents. So when you observe, or when you observe a particular social phenomena, or when you observe a particular respondent's behavior in a particular social setup, the willingness of the respondent, it is independent of that. So the respondent may be agreeing to respond, or the respondent may not agree to respond, may show cooperation, may not show cooperation. So it is independent of the respondent's willingness. Sometimes, for example, we observe certain social phenomena when we see that the respondent is unaware of it. So these kind of observation sometimes definitely has got lot of scope for the respondents not to respond in a particular situation. And in spite of his non-response, an observation can be undertaken as a method of scientific inquiry. Observation method might have certain limitations also. When we look into the limitations of observation method, we see that sometimes we come to understand or try to analyze social phenomena with a specific purpose in our mind, but sometimes we do not get to see or get to observe wanted to observe exactly. We do not exactly see what the respondents would be behaving or the actual social behavior. So this would be one of the limitations of the observation method, when the researcher sometimes may not exactly get to see what the researcher wants to observe. And sometimes due to natural conditions, the researcher might not get a proper scenario, proper space to look into the particular social phenomena. So observation method has got disadvantages and advantages. Now learners, let us see or find out what are the kinds of observation. When we look into observation method, we see it can be participant observation and it can be non-participant observation. Participant observation is a method of observation which is largely used by many sociologists, and it has been very successful with ethnographic researchers and with anthropologists, lot of anthropologists, social anthropologists who try to understand tribal language, tribal behavior, tribal cultural patterns. So what is a participant observation? How do we understand participant observation? Participant observation would mean deeply engaging with the lifestyles, with the cultural patterns, with the social phenomena as a researcher. The researcher would be actively participating in the behavior patterns, in the activities of the subjects he's going to study. So generally, many of the sociologists have studied delinquent behavior through participant observation method. So participant observation method is an interesting and important method when we do detailed analysis of a social science phenomena, or we conduct a social science research. It is also a best known method in social science research because it delves deeply into the society, into the social life of the subject. So it is an in-depth study of the society and the subject. For example, you must have learnt about many social anthropologists who have studied language systems among aboriginals or cultural traits of the aboriginals. They have to go and stay with the subjects. They have to have an understanding about the language systems. They need to learn the language of the tribals or the aboriginals to understand exactly what cultural traits or cultural patterns they have imbibed, or to understand the generations of the cultural transmission of cultural traits to these social groups or tribal groups. So participant observation, you can say, has contributed immensely in understanding cultural behavior patterns because it tries to delve deeply into engaging with the subject to which the researcher would like to engage in or study or interpret. Now, non-participant observation. What is non-participant observation? It is another method of observation in which the researcher does not actually participate in the activities of the group. There is no emotional involvement on the part of the observer, and the observer is present in the group and records the events. For example, you need to study the impact of rural literacy on development. You need not participate exactly in the activities of people who are residing in rural areas, but one can observe or go to a particular literacy mission or particular school and look into how it has resulted in developmental activities. So observation can be both participant and non-participant. Learners, now let us move on to another technique of research, which is a survey method. You must have seen in day-to-day situations that people come to your houses or to neighborhood to do a survey. And when you ask them, they would say it is just a survey which we are doing to find out certain preferences or to find out certain things about a certain population. So survey method means a comprehensive examination of some aspect of social life, history, problems, etc. of a particular locality. For example, when a surveyor comes to the field to understand or to households, a survey can be done within the households, within the communities and within institutions, and many other aspects of a survey can be undertaken. For example, you must have seen people doing a survey on the usage of mobile phones. So people come to the houses and see what kind of mobile phones people prefer, the younger generation prefer these days. So it's a consumer survey. So when you look into surveys provide a detailed account of the people in question or the society in question in a particular locality. Now let us see how we can classify surveys or what kind of surveys we have. For example, we have a descriptive survey, a survey which aims to describe what exists. So in the survey questionnaire, you will be having descriptions about what is existing in the society. About, for example, it is a survey about people's preferences on the use of mobile phones. So you will be learning about a total description about what is existing with people, what kind of mobile technology they are using, how well versed they are with that technology. So it would be just a description about households and how they use a particular gadget. Secondly, there is another kind of survey which is explanatory, which means that it needs to explore the causal relationship. For example, what would be an impact of a poverty reduction program in reducing poverty in a particular area? So it would be an cause and effect relationship. What would be the cause of poverty? What impact it has on people? And for example, from a policy perspective, you try to understand if there are poverty reduction strategies, what impact it has or what effect it has on the population's overall development or reducing poverty index. Now, explanatory surveys are mostly done in researches which try to explore the cause and effect of social phenomena. Learners, let us move now to understand the third kind of surveys, which is predictive. Predictive surveys predict future changes and impact of certain policies. So, for example, you need to do a survey or you see surveyors come and try to understand what would be the future trends. For example, surveys which are done on software changes, new technology. So as you know, learners, the technology keeps on changing every day and there are new technology addition to the knowledge systems. So when we look into, for example, in mobile technology, you have different technologies like Android technology, other technologies. So now when you look into predictive survey, they will be giving you an understanding about what will be the future course of action or what would be future technology which would be there. Similarly, predictive surveys also, if you look into some of the studies on education and look into the graphs where children are moving in education, which field they are moving into education, you will be able to predict that which will be the prominent job options for these students who are studying these disciplines. So these are predictive surveys. The fourth category is evaluative. Evaluation studies or evaluative surveys are generally done to evaluate the results of past policies. For example, in the ministries, different government departments, they have various schemes for the upliftment of the people, for the welfare of people. Now they want to see that whether these schemes are properly affecting in a positive sense to the people, whether they are useful for the people. So they do a evaluation study. For example, you need to look into evaluation of the National Child Labour Project, which is for children who are child labour and they are rescued and put into the national child labour schools. So the government has this child labour project, but every year the government needs to do an evaluative study to look into the impact of these schools on children's future. Learners, now let us move to the third method, is the questionnaire method. The questionnaire is generally a most common instrument of data collection. It consists of number of questions printed or typed in a definite order on a form or set of forms. Questionnaire method also does not give you enough scope to the investigator to manipulate the data because there are fixed questions which are in printed format. It also offers greater anonymity to the respondent. While filling of the questionnaire, it may not be necessary that you put exactly the name of the respondent. Generally, it is used in a literate population. So, questionnaire method is one of the best instruments of data collection because questions are planned or which are framed through a proper systematic procedure to understand a particular social phenomena or social behavior. And the field investigator or the researcher who wants to implement the questionnaire on the population, they do not have enough scope to manipulate because the questions are already designed and well framed. So, they cannot manipulate the data. So, the questionnaire method appears to be one of the best tools for data collection. What would be the advantages of a questionnaire? Let us see. It has or involves a low cost even when the universe or large sample is widely spread geographically. So, the cost factor in the questionnaire is very less. Even if it is administered for a larger sample, it is the same questionnaire which is administered and spread geographically across the whole country if it is a larger sample. It is also free from bias of the interviewer as the answers are in the respondent's own words. As you all know, learners, that the questionnaires are generally used in the case of literate population. So, the interviewees or the respondents, they fill it up. And that is why it is their own handwriting, and the researcher or the observer or the person who is carrying out the research may not manipulate the answers. Respondents give adequate time to have a well thought out answers. So, questionnaire method, while answering, they will think and they have enough time to respond. Large samples can be drawn and the results can be more dependable and reliable. The questionnaires can be administered through large samples or large sample population and the results can be more dependable and reliable. We all know, learners, that when we use most of the large samples, then the results are more dependable because you get to have the computation or the data analysis drawn from a larger number of sample size. So, questionnaire method have definitely advantages in a social science research. Now, there are some essentials of a good questionnaire. Now, let us move and see what are the main aspects of a questionnaire and what is a good questionnaire. The main aspects of a questionnaire would be the general form. For example, a questionnaire can be framed in a general form. For example, you have closed-ended questions like yes and no. You must have seen questions asking whether your workplace is far or near, yes or no. There are many options. Do you take a mode of transport, yes or no, to your workplaces? So, general form of questionnaires would be closed-ended and it would have a yes-no option to tick. Then the second aspect of a questionnaire is the question sequence. What kind of sequence the questionnaire follows, whether it is sequenced in a very sequential good manner. For example, all the questions are following from the previous one. So, it has got a specific sequence. The third aspect is the question formulation and wording. It should be easily understood, simple and uniform. Learners, what happens is that when we have long questions and when we have a long questionnaire, the respondent might not be interested to answer. So, it is always advisable for a good questionnaire to be framed in a simple language, which should be easily understood by the respondents, and also it should be uniform. There should be some uniformity which should be maintained throughout the whole questionnaire. Now, let us move on to see the essentials of a good questionnaire. So, how would a good questionnaire look like? A good questionnaire would be short and simple, that is, the size should be minimum. question should be in a logical sequence, should be following a logical sequence. Technical terms and vague expressions need to be avoided. For example, we may not use subject-oriented jargons in the questionnaire. We may not use technical terms which the respondent is not aware of. So, we should be using very simple terms. Questions may be dichotomous, like yes, no, multiple choice, or open-ended. And then the next thing about a good questionnaire is that the physical appearance of the questionnaire, including the quality of paper, needs to be good in order to appeal to the respondent. So, these are some of the essentials of a good questionnaire. Learners, now let us move on to the next technique, the interview method. The interview technique generally refers to a conversation between the investigator and the informant, and it can be applied with a non-literate population. You must have seen people conducting interviews, people coming to villages, people taking interviews from Panchayati Raj institutions, local community members, and through many discussions. So, interview method generally follows through face-to-face interaction. According to sociologist Goodey and Hart, interview method, the schedule is the name applied to a set of questions which are asked and filled by the interviewer in face-to-face situation with one another. So, when you look into the interview method, it can be done either through structured formal interview or unstructured informal interview. In the structured formal interview, you have a fixed structure of questions formulated which you need to ask to the respondent. And in the unstructured interview, it generally flows through the discussions. You may not have a structured questionnaire. It might be unstructured and it might flow, or the questions might flow as the discussions would continue. So, when you have different kinds of discussions, there might be new things coming up when you discuss a particular issue. So, the unstructured questionnaire would take up all those issues into consideration because the questions are not formulated accordingly. Now, what are the types of interviews? Structured interviews, you see that it uses a high quality standardized questions, and in unstructured interviews, it does not follow a system or list of, you know, pre-decided questions, and respondents are free to share their experiences, narrate their experiences, and responses can flow through the conversation. Now, we move on to see the advantages of the interview method. The research interview is not a separate or independent tool, as it is supplementary to other techniques. A combination of interviewing, observational and statistical techniques often yields best results. So, the interview method is flexible, as questions not readily grasped, they can be explained and rephrased. For example, the respondent does not understand what the interviewer is asking. So, there is a lot of scope for the interviewer to explain, to be flexible in his approach and explain to the respondent what he means to ask. So, there are a lot of advantage of this interview method. An interview method has been used in lot of social survey researches. Then the next method, learners, would be the case study method. What is a case study now? It is to understand human behavior, we know that, and to understand fully and very carefully, we need to provide a detailed and penetrating account of what a person does, what he thinks, that needs to be understood. So, a case study method is an exhaustive study of a person or a group, and it provides a detailed, penetrating account of an individual's behavior. Frederick Lipley introduced the case study method in social sciences in his study of family budgets, and you must have seen that many of the researchers recently and in the past, they use specific cases, because case study method deals with specific cases. It in fact proceeds with an analysis of specific cases. These are in fact in-depth investigations, and this case, what may be a case? A case may be a person, a group, or an institution. So, all data relevant to the case are gathered and organized as per the case. The research may also continue for an extended period of time. So, processes and developments can be studied as they happen. So, in the case study method, learners, you would see that if you select a particular case, you delve deeply with that particular case, keep on asking probing questions, build a case, and also continue it for an extended period of time, go back again and also see what developments have taken place with that particular case. So, case study methods are very good in the sense for qualitative researches to be undertaken, because it provides a detailed, depth, in-depth understanding about any particular social phenomena. So there is no scope for limited information. It in fact provides a broader or greater information about the social phenomena. Generally, anthropologists and ethnologists have used the case study method for detailed description of primitive and modern cultures. So when you try to interpret and understand primitive and modern cultures, the ethnographers and anthropologists have used the case study method. So learners, today we learnt about different techniques of social research, and we understood what kind of tools we use when we conduct a scientific social inquiry or when we try to understand a social phenomena. We understood observation, we understood interview method, we understood questionnaire, we understood case study and the survey methods. So learners, we learnt about important techniques of social science research today, and these methods will definitely be useful for any researcher who wants to undertake small studies or large scale studies. Thank you.